one. Welcome all parents, students, faculty, staff, and special guests to the school. To all who do not know my name is J. Daniel Kim, and I'm the student body president. Tonight we have a very special occasion, and we are excited to hear from actor, author, and activist, Phil Harper, this evening. Before we hear from Mr. Harper, I want to introduce you to John Snuggs, who graduated from Church Farm School in 2000. When Mr. Snuggs was a third grader in West Philadelphia, his class learned that they would be the recipients of the inaugural Jane and Robert Toth program of the Philadelphia Chapter Say Yes program, which would provide them with a full scholarship to college if they graduate high school. Ms. Toll helped Mr. Snuggs find his way to Church Farm School in 1996. After CFS, he received a communications and marketing degree from Eastern University and an MBA from Webster University. Mr. Suggs is currently the Executive Director of CF Charities outside of Philadelphia, which champions educational and enrichment opportunities for youth by providing them the tools, experience, and resources essential to developing them into the next generation of leaders in their communities. It was through this work that Mr. Suggs first met Mr. Phil Harper. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Suggs to CFS.
Hey family, how y'all doing tonight? I'm like, why is he so loud? I appreciate the welcome, but it really does feel good to be back home. It doesn't even feel like I've been gone for a minute here. And there were many times right in this area I was doing a wrestling tournament with Mr. Kistler and Mr. Smith, running and getting the scores together. So it feels really, really good to be back home. Won't you clap your hands for it? Really excited to be here. 100 years, huh? 100 years. I want to say, hey, no, stop, but I won't. I'll spare you of that. I can say a lot of things about my time here at Church Farm School. There was I'm going to take this off. There was a faculty member here. He was an alumni here, and he was always saying something like you know, this place changed my life, man. I mean, every time we saw him, it was, this place changed my life. I mean, we could be studying math. You know, how's math going? We were like, it's fine. Did this place change your life? Like, man. And we were like, man, do you have anything else other than this place change your life to share? And he was like, this place changed my life, man. I just, you know, it would break down every single time. And I got to tell you, when you're here, and these are for students, wave at me, fellas. Where you got your men, my brothers? All right. When you're here, you're like, man, I'm ready to get out. Your parents are here, but we can be ready to leave. But when you get out, I was talking to a group of folks in St. Louis, Missouri, and they were like, where did you go to high school? I'm like, I went to Church Farm School. I'm like, what do you like about it? Man, this place changed my life. And it's the truth. And so I'm a product of every person, every faculty member, dining hall staff. I want you guys to clap it up for the teachers, man. And you guys, it's just it feels really good to be back on campus. Also to the parents, thank you guys for being here. You know, there used to be a saying, behind every good man, there's a great woman. I don't buy that. I think the woman is in front or beside, not behind. I'm gonna switch it up a little bit. Behind every good student, in front of every good student, are great parents. And clap it up for yourself here tonight. I would be remiss if I didn't thank my mother, who is here, who just walked in the door. Mom, stand up. Will you guys help me welcome my mother for Dennis Suggs? And just stand up one more right here. Wave to her. This is my mom. She made the sacrifice so that I could come here. And there were a lot of home-cooked meals that I missed, not too many, as you can see, but I recognize the sacrifice here. I want to introduce Hill Harper. I worked in the Boys and or Big Brothers Big Sisters in St. Louis, and Hill is a great, great friend and a great mentor. And he flew all the way from Seattle, Washington yesterday, tired. And I said, Hill, I need you here. You know, I got a little bias, you know, going in. You know, it's Hill Harper, it's my school. You know, I want to be here. I said, I need you here. And he changed his schedule to make it possible to be here. And I'm excited that you are here. But I was working for Big Brothers Big Sisters, and we had an award ceremony, and this is the way I feel about Hill. We had an award ceremony, a little brother gets on stage, and they ask him, they say, listen, what's the number one thing you like about your mentor? Like, what's the number one thing you like about him? And I thought that he was getting ready to say, oh, it's the basketball games that we go to, or, you know, it's this event, that event that he takes me to. And he blows the entire crowd away, and he makes this statement. He says, the thing that I like most about my mentor is he didn't tell me what to do. He lived his life and allowed me to watch. Powerful. It's the same thing that people did at Church Farm School. They didn't tell you what to do. They lived their life and allowed me to watch. And that's what Hill did for me, and I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful. Hill Harper is an award-winning actor, best-selling author, and philanthropist. Harper starred on the hit CBS drama CSI New York. Anybody see? Yes. He's also in HLN's How It Really Happened with Hill Harper and Showtime's award-winning series Homeland. This fall, it started already, the number one drama in the country. He stars as Dr. Marcus Andrews on a highly anticipated or highly successful show now, The Good Doctor on ABC. In theaters, he can be seen in the movie Concussion, recently released to Fox Shakur's biopic All Eyes on Me. That was really good. Harper has earned 7 NAACP Image Awards for his writing and acting, and is a New York Times bestselling author for his books, Letters to a Young Brother, which was also named Best Book for Young Adults by the American Library Association in 2007, and Letters to a Young Sister, and The Conversation. Additionally, he has written letters to an incarcerated brother and The Wealth Cure, Putting Money in Its Place. Harper founded the Manifest Your Destiny Foundation, which is dedicated to empowering and encouraging and inspiring underserved youth to succeed through mentorship, scholarship, and grant programs. Hill Harper graduated magna cum laude as valedictorian of his department with a bachelor's degree from Brown University, cum laude with a Juris Doctorate degree from Harvard Law School. He also holds a master's degree with honors from Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government, holds an honorary doctorate, let's wait for it, degrees from Winston-Salem State University, Cheney University, Westfield State College, Toluca College, Lemoyne-Owen College, Dillard University, Howard University. Harper currently serves on the President's Cancer Panel, having been appointed by President Obama in 2011. Harper travels the world as a motivational speaker, addressing current affairs, life-awakening topics to a wide array of audiences and youth, adults, couples, and business leaders. He is also a job creator and an entrepreneur. Harper owns the Roasting Plant Coffee Roastery in Detroit. He owns a hotel in New Orleans and the Architecting Company, which is a health and wellness, health and wellness company. And this is pretty cool too. In 2004, People's Magazine named him one of the sexiest men alive. He loved that part. Not 1 year, but 2 years. Take a look at this video.
Author, actor, activist, and mentor Hill Harper has yielded his influence from Capitol Hill to the city streets. Rarely does a star use his celebrity with so much precision. His role on CSI New York helped to build his audience of fans, and he seized the platform to create change and offer hope. Hill's Manifest Your Destiny Foundation is a reflection of how he lives his own life, with confidence and an expectation that all things are possible. He's been especially effective in reaching young African-American men and women, giving them the chance for real exchanges with those who have figured out the answers to some of the problems that limit their potential.
These young people are never taught about journey. They're never taught about going from here to there and where education fits in that piece of the journey.
Will you help me give a Church Farm School welcome to Mr. Hill Harper?
It is so It's actually an honor for me to be here. And to have someone like my friend John welcome me here and say, man, I want you to come and see where I spent some serious formative years. It's important to me that you see this wonderful institution. And, you know, I'm the product of a public school system, and my campus was never as beautiful as this campus. And when I told people when I was going to school that I was going to go to Harvard, they laughed at my face. And when we talk about dreams and goals and talk about destiny, I want to talk about one word, and I want you guys to say this word with me real quick. And I want to be clear that what I'm going to talk about today is not just for the students. It's not just for the faculty or the administrators, and it's not just for the parents. It's for all of us. And this particular word that I want you guys to say with me is something that I want to focus on for a few minutes before John and I do a conversation or a Q&A. Will you say this word with me real quick? Say amplify.
Amplify.
I need you guys to say it a little loud. Say amplify.
Amplify.
That's right. So what I want you to think about for the purposes of this discussion is, what would it mean if you start to amplify your goals and dreams? And when I say amplify them, I'm talking about not just make them a little bit bigger, but I'm talking about make them vastly bigger. Because we're in a time and place in this world where this auditorium, this collection of individuals, can change the world. We have that ability collectively. One of my favorite quotes from Dr. King is, Dr. King said, we're all tied together in a single garment of mutual destiny. We're all tied together in a single garment of mutual destiny, which means to me that no matter how well I may be doing in Hollywood, or how well my business is doing, or how many honorary doctorates I have, if a young brother or young sister in Pennsylvania, in New York, in South Side Chicago, South Central LA, South Bronx is not doing well, then I'm not doing well. If a young man at the church farm school is not doing well, then I'm not doing well. And when I say doing well, I'm not just talking about getting by. I'm talking about amplify. I'm talking about, if you're not reaching your peak potential, if you're not expanding your goals and dreams to the place where you actually are impacting a wider footprint of individuals like my man John Suggs, then we have failed you somehow. And let's be clear, parents, sometimes you all can be the biggest dream killers of all. And the reason why you are, in many ways, sometimes dream killers is that you dissuade your child from taking the necessary risks that are involved of stepping out into uncertain territories. Of course, you love your children so much that you don't want to see them get hurt. So you say, well, take the safe path, all right? There are more jobs in this area than that area, so study this so you can get a job here. No. What if your young person is the person who's actually going to start a new business or a job that doesn't even exist yet? And you're going to dissuade him potentially from doing that. We need you to be just as courageous as the young person to say, I'm going to not project my fears on them, which for me, fear stands for false evidence appearing real. If you ever read any of my books, I talk about fears being the biggest killer of all. Too many of us stop ourselves. Too many of us project our fears on other people. Too many of us end up living a smaller life than we are meant to live. And then we have kids. And we say, well, I didn't quite amplify my life the way I wanted to, so now I'm going to put all my goals and dreams into my child. And then I'm going to project all my fears that stop me from amplifying onto them and say, well, I couldn't do it, so I don't think you can do it. And I'm going to hamstring them as well. Rather than saying, I'm going to make sure I don't project my fears on you. In fact, I'm going to encourage you to take more risks than I even had the ability to take. Do you think my parents wanted me to be an actor? Do you think that's a safe, secure job program? Do you think when I said, after having two graduates from
and all these job offers to be a lawyer. And I said, I'm going to go wait tables from 7 at night to 11 in the morning so I could be available to pound the pavement in New York City and do auditions and turn down these legal job offers. Do you think that they thought that was a good idea? And see, I'm one of the lucky ones who had parents that, although they had their fears about my choices, they didn't project them onto me. They always reminded me that there was nothing I couldn't do. And I want to remind each of us in this auditorium that there is more than nothing. There's nothing you can even think of or dream of that you can't create. In fact, I would push you to double and triple your dreams. And if when you articulate your dreams, whether you're a teacher, administrator, parent, or child, because we all still have them. If you don't, why are you here? I would suggest to you that John Suggs' mom right here, as beautiful and as amazing she is, she holds still dreams, even though she got John through this school and she got it. And he's doing so well, and she can sit back and look back. She's not done yet. She wants to see him do certain things still. She still wants to do certain things. And that's important. It's important to remember. So when we think about the idea of amplification, it means it's a little louder. And if I say to you, Church Farm School, if I say to you, last night I took an L, but what did I do tonight? What did I do? I bounce back. So, what does that mean? If I have an obstacle in my life, if something comes up where I have to take an L, where I fail, what do I do?
Bounce back.
That's right. And remind me of this. Who here actually likes failure? Come on, be honest. Who here likes failure? Who likes failure? Okay, good. Hey, come here. Why are you guys mumbling? You guys make it seem like I made a mistake to bring him over. Come here. Anthony. So Anthony, I said, who here likes failure? And in this room of, you know, a few hundred folks, Anthony raised his hand. You're like one of the only people to raise your hand. Why did you raise your hand?
It's the only way you learn.
Anthony, I love Anthony. And if you guys ever have the willingness after this talk to ever invite me back, I would hope that you amplify Anthony. And the reason why is because I would hope that the next time I come back and I ask that question is that every single hand in this auditorium goes up. Because if you don't like failure, you will never truly change the world. It's impossible. It's impossible. You have to love it. You have to welcome it. You have to walk into it. You have to cherish it. Because if you're not failing, you're not bumping up against amplification. You're staying safe, and you're not learning anything because you're not going to new territories. The greatest people you can name fail repeatedly, repeatedly, repeatedly. They live their life searching out there. I search out new ways to fail. Because last night I took a... And then what I do tonight? That's right. How can I bounce back if I don't do what? Exactly. And the beautiful thing about bouncing back is that I bounce higher every time. People say, Hill, how can you own a hotel? How can you own a coffee roastery? How can you be a 5-time New York Times bestselling author? How can you star on the number one new show on TV? Those things don't make sense. How can any person do all? Because I fail at it every time. There's about 100 other things I've tried and done that were horrendous, horrible failures. But you don't hear about those because I don't post them on my social media. I just post the video feed. we have to rewire ourselves. Where are you from?
Brooklyn, New York.
How'd you learn that lesson?
I'm in a program called All-Star Code, and our motto is Celebrate Failure.
Oh, man. Wow. Who else is in that program? Who else? And why didn't you guys raise your hands? Oh, sit down. Give them up. Give it up. Extending your reach and knowing that you are magnificent, knowing that you are brilliant, knowing that you are completely unstoppable. And the way you become unstoppable is to fail repeatedly. Do things that make you extremely uncomfortable. Walk into it. Walk into the unknown. Don't play it safe. How do you guys do the seating in classes here? I have no idea. How do you do the seating? Is it seating assignments or you sit where you want? Depends on the teacher? On the class? What is it for the most part? Just sit where you want. Do you guys tend to find that the same students tend to sit in the front class to class, or is it completely mixed up?
Mixed up.
Same students? Do you tend to find that the same students raise their hands and actually engage and ask questions, and then there's a subset of folks that actually never talk in class?
Yeah.
What do you think that's about?
Fear.
Fear.
Failure.
Fear.
That's interesting. Do we tend to think that the folks who engage more tend to get more out of the material, or you think the cats just sit back and never say anything, are the ones that really, like the quiet geniuses? Is it the quiet genius? Oh, that's what it is? Okay, come here, talk. Come here. Yeah, that's good. Because I don't know if he's a quiet genius or not. Come on, let's go. Let's go. He's a quiet genius right here. Are you the raise hand type or the quiet genius?
Raise hand.
Oh, so you're saying that the guys who sit in the back and never say they're smarter than you?
Sometimes.
Okay. But you sometimes, because you said that the quiet geniuses are the smart ones, and you say you're not that, so you're not smart.
Yeah, I think I'm smart, so.
Depends on what?
Just class to class. Like, not everybody who sits in the back might be smart geniuses. Some might not.
So how do you define achievement?
How do I define achievement? I guess just being satisfied with yourself and knowing that you did the best that you could, I guess.
Beautiful.
Don't clap for that. She's lucky she's not here. I was about to bring her up too. So being wait a minute, I don't want to get this right. So being satisfied that you did your best, is that what you're saying? Is it cheating?
Yeah.
Satisfied that you did your best. Okay, what's your best?
110%.
So, you're saying that achievement is about effort, or is it about result?
Combination of both.
Okay, how does the combo break out?
Well, most of the time, if you're putting in your best effort, not all the time, but most of the time, things start to pay off in your favor.
Okay, and then effort is synonymous with what? But it's okay. So, if you're putting in a lot of effort, but you're not yielding a result, what does that suggest to you?
Just try again.
Try again. So if I decided that I said, hey man, you see that wall over there? I want to put a hole in that wall. And you and I walked over and I said, you know what? This is how we're going to do this. You're going to start kicking the wall. And you know, over time, your kicks will impact the brick in a way that the brick's going to start to crumble down. And if you just keep kicking it, we're going to get that hole I need. What would your response be?
Might need some more stronger feet.
Right. You would take a step back. You would analyze the plan. And you would suggest to me that my plan, even though you're going to put in max effort, the plan is flawed to achieve the given result. That's what you would say. Because you're saying the brick is harder than my foot. Okay. So is success or achievement about effort?
Somewhat.
Somewhat. What would you say? Have you ever heard someone say you should work hard?
Yes.
Do a lot of people say work hard?
Yes.
What would you say to me if I said, whoever tells you work hard is wrong? What would you say?
Prove it.
Okay. And has anyone ever tell you, say, don't work hard, but work smart?
Yes.
Okay. Would you rather work hard or work smart?
Work smart.
Yes. Why?
Because, just like the example you provided, like, you might be working hard on the wall, but it might not be working to your favor. But if you, I guess, have a smarter plan or a better way to approach it, it'll probably work to your favor.
Thank you. Take a seat. So, is having a plan, having a blueprint, having something that is well thought out, being a critical thinker about your assets, your liabilities, your purpose, your goals, your mission, and then creating a plan and executing that plan, but also being smart enough to take a step back. If the way you're approaching the plan is not working, then you do something. There's another M word called modify the plan, right? And we can't leave that out of the discussion. It's not just about working hard. It's not just about effort and putting in max effort. It's about putting together a cogent, concise plan to figure out new and different ways to win, to amplify, to achieve, to execute. That's critical, and that's not just for students. That's not just for students. Going back to the point I was making about parents and their projections, part of your plan has to be to not project that fear. And then you have to figure out a plan about how to check yourself. Every time you want to do it, you may have to walk into a room and scream and then come back out. And maybe that's your blueprint or your plan. But the point is, you have to work the plan just as the student works their plan. And the same goes for teachers. I want to talk to you all about this. The best way to judge a class, and this is what I do when I show up and I do my little advising and counseling in schools, is that I show up outside the classroom and I judge the class simply by this. If the students are walking out faster than they walked in, there's a flaw in the class, and the flaw is the teacher and their methodology. Because I don't believe that it's ever the student's fault. Why? Because I believe that if you're putting together lesson plans and you're putting together something that is truly stimulating to a student, that you don't even have to worry about phones and technology and distractions and note passing and whispering and talking. Because if you're not actually engaging enough with your material and your presentation of the material to actually maintain their attention, to get them excited to run into your class, then you have a flawed plan of and methodology of teaching. And folks never want to hear that, because they always want to think that the student needs to learn the way they want to teach it. But if you actually go to the student and you learn what they love, and then you teach whatever around it. I used to carry around, for instance, when I would do a financial literacy talk, I would carry around this black card from American Express. Any of you guys know what that is? What is it? A black card. A black American Express credit card. What is it? It's a card that has no limit. It has a high monthly fee. Where did you learn that? Online. And what's interesting about that card is that there was a lot of cats who were like, this is interesting. I've never met somebody who has that card. But then we could use that as a teaching tool to talk about this card, right? Because the card doesn't make sense, right? Because at the end of the day, they say, I'd like to have a card like that, but I would actually like to ask the question about, well, who's the CEO of the company that creates that card? And then we'd have to do some research. We find out it was Ken Chenault, a brother who went to Harvard Law School. And then I would say, who do you think, just give me an example of folks out there that make a lot of money.
Trump. Myself,
I live in Brooklyn. I go to Harlem a decent amount. I appreciate you. What street?
135th.
Okay. I'm around that area every once in a while. You ever go to Rosado State up on 116th and 3rd Avenue?
No.
Okay, you'll go sometime. So he said Trump makes a lot of money. We believe that to be true. Do we believe that to be true? That's interesting. So what makes you believe, just so I understand, that Trump makes a lot of money?
I've been to Atlantic City.
Okay. So you're referring to seeing his name up on buildings, like the Trump Casino and stuff like that.
Yes.
So are we suggesting that if we see someone's name on a building, that immediately tells us that they make a lot of money?
Not necessarily.
Okay, so why are we assuming, or are you saying, that Trump makes a lot of money? I'm not saying you're wrong. I just really want to understand.
Because of the position that he holds in society.
Okay. So, what position does he hold?
He's the president of the United States.
Okay. So are you now suggesting, I'm just trying to understand the train of thinking where we're going, that you have to be rich to be president?
No.
Okay. So, but you just told me that you believe he makes a lot of money because of the position he holds, and I asked you, do you have to make a lot of money to hold that position? And you just said no. So I'm trying to understand. I'm trying to reconcile the two things.
It's not that you need to make a lot of money to be president, but because of the money that he's inherited and because of the money that he has.
Okay, so you just said a word. Now, inherited is different than made. I asked you who makes, and you said Trump, but now you switch it to inherited. Now, did he inherit a lot of money or did he make a lot of money?
Both.
Okay, what's a lot?
A million.
How much money do you think I make?
A lot.
See, I like you. And I see a future. I see a future as a really good lawyer. Because I like someone who can really tap dance. Like, let me think about what I can say, or what I should say, or how I should say it, or what I should do. What do you love? What do you enjoy?
Stuff like engineering and like math, things of that nature.
What grade are you?
I'm a freshman. I'm in ninth grade.
Ninth grade. How you doing here?
Good.
Yeah? You sit in the front or the back? Are you a quiet genius or do you actually raise your hand?
Both.
All right, so check it out. I wrote this book called Letters to a Young Brother. I wrote it just for somebody like you. John, when we're done, give me a copy. I'm gonna give it to you. But what I need from you is to read it, and then I need you to DM me on my Instagram what you thought about it, and give me kind of a breakdown of your thoughts about the book and what your biggest takeaways were. Will you do that for me? Okay. Thank you so much. So, John is like, we're going to start the Q&A, which is fine. But before we do, I want you guys to say one more thing with me. It wasn't until I got to Hollywood that I realized why a lot of entertainers had entourages. And a lot of them have entourages because a lot of the stuff I've been talking about, this idea of amplification, in one specific way, entertainers are trying to amplify, right? They're trying to become so-called stars, you know, in quotes. They're trying to become famous, in quotes, right? So they're trying to amplify in one specific way. And you realize part of what's required in terms of amplification is being willing to step out. And it becomes partly a confidence game. And so what a lot of entertainers do is they have entourages. They're basically paid friends to whisper in their ears about how great they are and how they can do it. And for many of us, we don't hire people for that. We have to be our own entourage. And so the way I do it is that I use affirmations. So I'm going to share one with you. And you can pull this out of the back of your mind or your back pocket anytime, because affirmations work. Because every time you feel like living a smaller life, every time you feel like not taking that risk, you may need to pump yourself up. You may need to look in the mirror and say something like this. Say this with me. I will not.
I will not.
I need you to say it a little louder, a little more energy. I will not.
I will not.
Allow fear.
To stop me
from making the choices that I already know I should make. Instead, I will live my life fearlessly, with courage, with my heart, and with a plan. And in so doing, win at my life. And I will give others permission to win as well. God bless you guys. Thanks so much.